supposed to think that, I believe. Another major message is, of course, the pain of hell will be worse after the judgment because people will be able to feel it more than they did before the final judgment. At level 2B, the symbolism, well, taco, obviously, right? I mean, you eat yourself to death when you're alive, and undisciplined actions, of course, are going to be representative of Chaco. Florence is, of course, symbolized as well as the fallen city, the corrupted city, the city of schism, political Dante having his day here, right? The irony, think about this, during life, they love, like Chaco, they love leisure, they love eating, they love the good things of life, and of course, now they roll around in the mud and the stench, right, in their death like hogs. It's kind of gross. It's a powerful word picture. Think about Dante as poet. He borrows, obviously, from the Odyssey with Circe changing the men into pigs. It is a graphic word picture, and we're going to see more of this as we go forward. Think about Dante as politician. No question he's borrowing heavily from his study of Plato, and more particularly that notion of declension of state, and the idea that disharmony, in the end, is what killed Florence. Disharmony is the reason for Dante that he is in exile and having to write this poem outside of Florence, right? Again, we'll say this, others might wonder if Chaco gets mentioned, you know, as kind of the town glutton, I wonder who else Dante will mention in this poem. From the philosopher perspective, notice we're back to that mind-body dualism that we mentioned in our study of Plato. Of course, Descartes will play the same game for us. To what degree is there an interchange between those two things, and how does that all work out? Well, of course, this is again going to take us back to Book 6 and Book 7 of the Cave of Republic and the Cave Allegory and all of that. That two boxes as we sometimes play the game. Go back and look at those lectures if you need to. At 3A, we've mentioned it already, the Odyssey and Circe turning men into pigs. That is to say what maybe they already are, right? Remember in the Odyssey as well, there was lots of eating. Do you remember this? They reached out for the good things in life over and over again. We pointed that out in our study of the Odyssey. Notice now here it is taken to its penultimate extreme, where the only thing that mattered to Chaco and to people like him was a good meal, cuisine, and of course the luxury that went with it. Again, going back to that comment from Plato's Republic, remember when he outlines his ideal republic as being very Spartan-like, you'll remember that that Glaucon will say, well, it doesn't seem like there's going to be much fun. Really? You want to have fun? That means you're going to have leisure. That means you're going to need to have doctors because you're going to have all kinds of people who are sick all the time. By the way, what are the films that come to mind about having anything to do with gluttony? The movie Seven, Brad Pitt's film, comes to mind. It's a disturbing film, but when they mess around with the seven sins, some have argued that thing about the gluttonous is one of the most disturbing of all of that. At 3B, well, you knew this was coming. I mean, let's ask about it. What is your relationship with cuisine and food? For example, do you think it's wrong to eat too much, to overeat? Do you think it's wrong to be overweight? Or is it just something that's unhealthy? This is one of those interesting kind of debates from the medieval period where if you overate, you know, you kind of were seen as a bad person. What are your thoughts on that? Speaking of that, how do you break a bad habit? I mean, if you know, for example, that you eat bad stuff or not good cuisine or you eat too much or something, how do you go through the process of breaking a bad habit? Well, that's Canto 6. Let's get on now to Canto 7, Circle 4. And here we're going to have an interesting debate because we're going to meet two kinds of people. Those who basically can't ever save any of their money. They just spend it all like crazy. They're going to be called the prodigals. You'll remember our story from the 1611 King James Version of the Bible, the prodigal son. We're going to be playing a very similar kind of game here, giving it away. Or they're misers and they never want to share anything that they got. In Dante's hell, either one of those two groups will be punished in fascinating ways. Come back and we'll talk about that one next. Thank you.